Good morning and welcome to today's edition of the CFNC Wednesday webinar series for spring of 2015. This is the first Wednesday of near spring. It actually feels spring-like outside, and I am very excited about that. I hope everyone has recovered from all the snow and that you too are looking forward to some warmer temperatures here. Thanks so much for joining us for today's presentation entitled How to Ruin Your Life Online. For those of you who would prefer to use your telephone, the toll-free number and the access code are here on your screen. If for any reason the audio on your computer, mic and speakers is not optimal, you can call in for the webinar audio. I've also posted a screenshot of the attendee control panel that each of you probably have on the right side of your computer screen. You can minimize that panel using that reddish-orange arrow if you want to hide it so that you have a fuller view of the webinar presentation screen. You can do that. You can also use that full screen button to maximize the size of the webinar presentation. If at any point during today's presentation you have a question or a comment, you are free to raise your hand using the electronic hand with the green arrow on it. And we also invite you to submit questions and comments through the questions box. It may even be that the presenter will have some questions for you, and you can respond to those questions during the presentation by texting in your answer in the questions box and just pressing send. So again, welcome, and we're going to move into a quick introduction and an overview of CFNC before we get right into today's presentation. My name is Gwen Rolak. I work as part of the CFNC Pathways team as the Director of Professional Development. One of my roles is, of course, to offer webinars to educators, including school counselors, career development coordinators, school administrators, Gear Up staff, members of the College Advising Corps. Those are some of the primary folks who participate in the online professional development that I offer through CFNC, but I also deliver face-to-face professional development on using the career and college planning tools that are available through CFNC, as well as facilitate some online courses for school counselors and CDCs. CFNC is a partnership made up of the six educational entities that you see represented around this wheel here. For those of you who are familiar with CFNC, you've seen this wheel quite a lot, and you know that the University of North Carolina, all of our independent and private colleges and universities in North Carolina, as well as our community college system, are all key partners. In addition, the Department of Public Instruction, so our K-12 system in North Carolina, is another partner. The State Education Assistance Authority works with North Carolinians on completing the FAFSA and other financial aid efforts. College Foundation Incorporated administers the 529 College Savings Program for the state. And so all of these six partners came together in 2000, so 15 years ago, with the mission of increasing the college-going rate of North Carolinians. And today that mission is still at the forefront of the work that CFNC does. And we also want to begin to take a look at not just college-going and college access, but also college success. You know, how are North Carolinians doing in terms of completing college and earning a credential with their post-secondary work? A few statistics. I always just want to update CFNC users and participants on the number of accounts that have been created. College applications are at 4 million, having been submitted, many of those to North Carolina community colleges. Excuse me, and then 1.6 million electronic high school transcripts have been delivered to North Carolina colleges, as well as North Carolina scholarship opportunities. CFNC allows students to create an account. It's a free account that begins in middle school, or it can begin in middle school, and then students would have access to that account for the rest of their lives, and it would be very helpful to them as they go throughout high school, into college, and even beyond. Many of the career assessments that are available on CFNC can be useful to adults who maybe even are considering a change in their careers. The beauty of the account is that it belongs to the students. So when students change schools, whether it's because of a transition after eighth grade into high school, or maybe the family just moves in the middle of a school year, the student is able to update their profile to their new school, but still access that same CFNC account. This is a screenshot of the various tabs that are available to students when they create a CFNC account. The blue tab is the profile and portfolio tab, where students are able to store many of their activities as it relates to college and career planning. Under the plan tab, there are specific activities and assessments, informational pages, as students are planning for high school, for college, and for a career. In the senior year, the purple tab is especially important, as our high school seniors are applying to college and applying for financial aid. We have a link to the FAFSA.ed.gov site on our page, because oftentimes students believe they need to apply for financial aid through CFNC, so you want to make sure that they get to the right site and not some of the proprietary sites that may be out there that would charge students to fill out the free application for federal student aid. The pay and save tabs are of a special interest to our parents, who are often, wondering, how am I going to pay for my student to go to college? The pay tab has information on financial literacy. There are some games for elementary right on through high school and beyond. There are financial literacy courses that students can take. And high school seniors who make at least an 80% on the financial literacy course are automatically entered into a drawing for a $500 scholarship. And then the Save tab has information about the North Carolina 529 College Savings Program. For as little as $25, anyone can open up a 529 college savings plan and begin saving toward a child or a grandchild or a neighbor. You really could save toward any person's college if that is what you would choose to do. For those of you who would like to request a Professional Center account, if you don't already have one, this is the email address, cfnc@northcarolina.edu, to which you can make a request for a PAC. You would send in your first and last name, email address, phone number, information about your school, and then once you have that PAC, you would be able to go to the Pro Center site and establish a Professional Center account, which would allow you to monitor many of your students' academic, career, and college planning steps. Today I'm very excited to welcome Eric Chancy to conduct our webinar for today, How to Ruin Your Life Online, and I'm going to turn the presentation over now so that we can get started. Again, thank you all for being here, and I'm going to turn it over to Eric.
Good morning. As Gwen said, my name is Eric Chancy, and I'm a senior administrator with the Wake County Public School System. That's the extent of what I'm going to tell you for right now, because one of the first goals of this presentation is to make sure that we talk about how people find information online and how people have the opportunity to mess their opportunities up by their online behavior. So, the first thing that I'm actually going to ask you to do is, for the next 90 seconds, I want you to find me. That's the spelling of my name up top, Eric-Chancy, and in the chat box, I'd like you to indicate what you find. By the way, do not be afraid to put anything up there, because we need to talk about one of those results in particular, and we'll discuss more about that in just a minute. Yes, I do. I live in Apex. Good. LinkedIn profile. Keep going. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know what the this is, so you'll have to explain it. Ah, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. But that is definitely what I was talking about. Yes, now that is accurate. That is accurate, too. Accurate? Yes. I think the Zoom info is right. Okay, professional resume. Correct. Okay, so we're going to back up 1 minute, and we're going to talk about that other piece that was found. So in order to do that, I'm going to show everybody what they were talking about, and that is right here. The North Carolina DPS offender public information. Now, why do I bring this up? Well, first of all, because you don't know me. You've never seen me before unless we've met in person or unless you've looked up images of me online. Now, this could be me, this could not be me, but if I am somebody who is seeking a job, it's kind of important that I know anything out there that could be loosely associated with me, even if it's not me. Now, there are a couple pieces in here that if you don't know me and if you've not met me and if all the information you've ever learned about me is online, you might not be able to know. You might not, by yourself, figure out that my middle name is J, not L. It's not a big distinction. You might not make the assumption that I am or am not black. This birthday, by the way, is really super close. It's only 8 months out from, or 9 months out from my true birthday. And so there's a lot of information here that would be close to me. And what's interesting is I don't have a very common name. I don't know how many people with the last name of Chansey any of you know, but there aren't too many of us. And there certainly aren't too many Eric Chanseys, but there are three of me in North Carolina, and one of them is this gentleman here. Another one is a guy who lives probably 2 hours away, and then there's me. All right. So let's one of the things I really want to drive home with you is that our kids need to know what information is out there that is A, about them, and B, could be associated with them because it's close. So, little background information, quick history lesson. Here's how all of this started. Your ability to go in and look at this information online. This thing right here, this monstrosity that weighed 60,000 pounds, 18,000 vacuum tubes, called the ENIAC, the Electronic Numerator, Integrator, and Computer. So then we progressed to this little thing that you could buy and make at home if you had enough savvy and you knew how to do it. How many of you, please, in the chat box, type yes or no, remember any of these? Which ones, by the way, which ones are collecting dust? The large ones, the middle, or the small? Large, medium, or small? Medium. That was what I originally worked with. And I have a big crate of the small ones. Do we have any of our participants who actually remember using the very large ones? No, because they couldn't hold much. In fact, they could only hold 80 kilobytes total. You couldn't run a program off of these. Okay, those wouldn't even store some of our Word documents at this point. The medium ones only ever held 360 kilobytes, and the small ones held 1.44 megs at the top side. Okay, so then we progressed to this. This is what is commercially available now. It's very expensive, but this is what is commercially available now. 1 terabyte on a thumb drive that you can take with you. That's 1,024 gigabytes or 1 million megabytes. That's crazy. It's crazy how much information is at your disposal and at the disposal of our children at this point. That's not a bad thing, but it's got to be regulated at some level. You know, and this is changing so fast. When we had electricity hit the U.S., 25% of the population used electricity within the first 46 years of it being commercially available. Telephone was 35 years, radio 31, 26, PC 16, mobile phone 13, and the World Wide Web, 7. Within 7 years, 25% of the population was using the World Wide Web. You can see that when technology is introduced into our society, new technology that catches fire, it exponentially gets a shorter time frame of large-scale usage. And so now, you know, the web is what we use every single day in all of our jobs, in almost everything that we do. The email that we use is communicated via the internet, the World Wide Web. The access to information, CFNC that Gwen was talking about earlier, you access that through the web. And again, you know, it's a wide-scale issue. How fast? Well, in 8 years, use on social media was up 800%. If you want a fantastic infographic on rapid change, that's here. And by the way, any of this is available. I will be happy to send any of you this PowerPoint for your own use. All you have to do is contact me. I'll give you my information at the end. But basically, you can look at the rapid growth of the internet here in this infographic, 1984 through 2013. Just look at the search queries, okay? Look at how many websites. From 1993, there were 130, 2012, 634 million. That's insane. And that's why we have companies that entirely exist on buying domain names and being able to sell them to people. If you look at the growth of some of our social media, in 2004, Facebook was launched. In 2012, more than a billion users. Twitter, 2006, 2012, doubled to 200 million users. Okay? This is how quickly social media is working within the framework of our society, and so we need to be cognizant of how it affects our kids. Is that a good or a bad idea? That's one. Okay, two, three, four. Okay, so I think we're agreed that this is a bad idea, okay? Why? Why is this a bad idea? Okay, that's fair. He's not old enough. There's a level of maturity that this student needs. He can barely see over the driver's, you know, over the wheel. His feet really probably can't reach the pedals. There's a lot of reasons that this is probably not a good idea. Good or a bad idea? And I won't ask you why, because it's about all the same reasons. Now, I saw one a second ago, doesn't understand, okay? I'm going to add to that, just to extrapolate a little bit, doesn't understand the implications and doesn't understand the ramifications of any decisions that are made behind that wheel. Likewise, this guy probably doesn't understand with the chainsaw. So why is this better? Why is this a better idea than this or this without training, supervision, or an expected level of maturity? And my answer to you is that it's not. Now, let me tell you what I am not. I love technology. I love it. I absolutely love it. I am not the boogeyman for technology, but I am absolutely an advocate for making sure that kids are properly trained on how to behave with this, this, and this. You're right. Not a good idea, but the phone is more socially accepted, okay? And there's a lot of peer pressure there. There's peer pressure from kids. There's peer pressure from parents. There's peer pressure all over the place. In fact, there are some schools at this point that when parents ask for information, where are we pushing those parents to? Yeah, we're pushing them to the web. They, in turn, also press their children to the internet for information, for entertainment, for all of it, okay? So now we've got a culture that is driven in this direction, but these guys are being handed this device at this age or younger without any direction and any conversation taking place on appropriate use. And that is creating huge problems. And many of you are seeing that. Many of you are seeing, in fact, in my dissertation study, one of the primary issues that counselors reported was the just en masse issues that social media is perpetuating in our schools. But I want to drive a point home around that. Social media does absolutely nothing all by itself. Social media without somebody typing on a keyboard or talking into their phone is not able to communicate anything. There is a real person on the other side of that who is creating that message, who is sending out that text, who is tweeting out a particular note that is in turn creating that drama. And so it's important that we teach our kids what needs to happen. Technology is actually reshaping human behavior. And if you have doubts about that, there are studies that are being conducted right now and have been conducted over the last several years that deal with how technology is changing us physically, and mentally. So again, these links, and I don't want to go through all of these links because, quite frankly, it'll be several hours on the webinar and you don't have that time and I don't have that time. But I'm happy to send all of that to you. It'll be in the PowerPoint that I send if you want to get it from me. So we'll talk about social stuff in just a few minutes. But environmentally, there are 50 million tons of waste being created each year, electronic waste being created each year, that revolve around the World Wide Web and Internet technology. The average phone is 1.1 pounds. So now we've got 91 billion phones and 17 billion laptops. Bitcoin is being used to pay for things. And there are a number of different options like Google Wallet or, you know, anything else that you can use where an electronic payment is the choice of the consumer. And this is going to change the way our society operates. When we talk about mobile computing, by the way, this was a statistic that I pulled from last year, but the reality is that mobile computing has actually already overtaken desktop and laptop web browsing. So mobile computing has already beaten this out. It wasn't predicted until 2017, but it's already happened now in 2015. So here's the number one challenge that we face in education. And you know this. I'm not telling you anything new. The law has not caught up with technology. It can't, because technology comes out as a function of our economic system. I mean, when an app is developed, its purpose is to make money. Provide a service, make money. That's why investors throw money at it, and it's created almost instantly. But legislation takes months, sometimes years, sometimes decades to pass. And so school districts are operating with old information when it comes to modern technology. Here's the other thing. Are we being bad examples? Now, I would certainly hope that none of my participants could claim to be bad examples, but you have probably seen issues at your own schools where we have staff members who are being bad examples. How many of you, just with a yes or a no, would say you've seen at least one example of a staff member being a bad example for our kids relative to electronic resource usage? Yeah, I don't see any no's in there. I see, yeah, there are no no's in there, okay? So the reality is, I mean, the people who are supposed to be examples in all cases are also guilty of this. This is actually a divorce decree that I came across, all right? Now, if these parents, if this is the way they behave and a judge has to spell out how they are supposed to behave online toward each other, then how does anybody expect their kids to behave any differently? Somebody's got to be their example. Hopefully they're getting that example from someone as opposed to the home. And I mean, there's all kinds of things going on here, so obviously there are lots of issues, but this is just an example. And this is happening with our sports icons as well, people who our kids look up to. NFL bullying that was taking place and was reported and was perpetuated by social media. You know, we saw an example not too long ago that dealt with Oklahoma State University, an absolutely disgusting example of people being brought out to bear on how they really behave through social media. And that's one of the things our kids need to know, is even if your social media all by itself, if you're behaving online, your real life is probably going to spill out onto the internet at some level, and maybe you need to clean up your act. Well, the second challenge that goes along with that is school districts can't keep up with technology or social media changes. I want you to look at these for a minute. In fact, I'm going to stop right there. I want you to tell me in the chat box about other social network sites that you know that aren't listed here so far. Go ahead. Now, I don't think I have Chive on the list quite yet. Are you guys familiar with After School? Has anybody been hit with this one in particular yet? Okay, well, let me tell you real quick about After School.
posting, and I've got to tell you, we can't even show most of what's posted because it is so explicit. Tonight, school officials and law enforcement sending out a warning. They're asking parents to keep a close eye on what their children are doing on apps like this one. Amy Johnston is concerned about what her three children can see on social media.
There's just so much out there that we parents have to stay on top of it.
The latest app is called After School. It allows students to post anonymous messages, including sexually explicit content.
Anytime you make something anonymous, people do and say things that, if they were to identify themselves, would be embarrassed and humiliated.
It's very frustrating because it's an easy way to do it for the kids, and they don't really hold themselves accountable.
Local school districts and police departments, including Burton, Kersley, Grand Blanc, and Davison, taking to the internet to warn parents.
Once you hit that post or that send or whatever that button is, it's out there forever.
Okay, now, that was a very important statement. And I want you to think about something for a minute. So we're going to get away from this, and again, you know, all links are available. I'm happy to share this PowerPoint with you. But when you send something through, let me say that differently. When I hit send on my phone, what happens next? Do you know? Do any of you know what happens next? Where does it go next? And what is the cloud, by the way? Okay. And that's fair. That's fair, because a lot of people really don't know. When I have my phone and I send a message, it goes to a server. Now, the cloud is really a group of servers, a large group of servers. And so when you're sending something like that, it's not like it goes, you know, in the air and hangs out for a couple of minutes and gets bounced to whoever it's supposed to go to. It's being transmitted through a server, through my service provider. It goes to your service provider through their server, and then it gets sent to you. So it's hit at least two servers and is stored in perpetuity. And it doesn't matter whether I delete it from my phone and you delete it from your phone. It exists somewhere. Your kids, your parents, your staff members, and you need to know that things that you send or transmit through any electronic device, even though they might say they're anonymous, they're not. Snapchat is a great example. Several years ago, Snapchat made the claim that you would send a message, and when the reader looked at it, it would disappear in a certain number of seconds. Yeah, it would disappear from their device, potentially. However, there were devices that were found later that had Snapchat on them that they were able to retrieve all kinds of information from. And regardless of whether it disappears from the device or not, it still exists on the server somewhere. Okay? So, how do we help our students? We have to help our students by letting them know that even though people are telling them that these things don't exist anymore, they exist forever in some fashion or another, and that people will be able to access them if they go through the legal means necessary. How often is that going to happen? It's not going to happen very often, but there are some instances where it does happen. This is just a picture with some of the many, many, many social networks out there. You'll notice that many companies have their own. Walmart is on here somewhere, okay? There are a ton of social networks out there that people don't even know about because they are exclusive to a particular set of either students or employees or people who are looking for a particular subject. And so there's a social network out there for almost everyone, good and bad. I mean, that goes in both directions. Now, one of the things that many people don't know is that there are apps out there that are designed specifically for people who are using something like Facebook or something like Snapchat to be able to hang on to that information even after it's deleted. And by the way, even if it is deleted from my phone eventually, when I send you a picture or I send you a text message, what do you have the ability to do the moment you see it? Yep, screenshot, save it, and then, now that you have it and it is in your possession, yep, you have the ability to post it. And you can post it to everyone, okay? So, case in point, there's a young lady who I'm actually going to get into a file folder here, so give me just a moment. This young lady's name is Amy Dunbar. Oh, no, it's not Amy Dunbar. Sorry, this is the wrong one. There's a young lady who was getting ready for a party at a college. And when she did that, she held up a sign. And when she held up the sign, she found out that her friends were not being very good friends, and they were sending that sign and that picture of her out over and over and over again. I should have put it in here, and I'm sorry that I did not, but that'll be a future post for my presentation. One of the things, and we're going to review this very, very quickly, there's light versus dark social. And what that means is light social is known social networks. That's the stuff that is Facebook, Snapchat, all the stuff that you easily know about. Dark social is the stuff that happens with text messages, the stuff that even happens with email. Basically, it's the stuff that is not open to the public that you'll never see if you're not being directly communicated with, unless, again, it's reposted or resent by someone. This is much larger than this is. In fact, worldwide, 69% of what happens through the internet is dark social. So can you imagine what happens, like the problems that you're seeing that are perpetuated through social networks, can you imagine what's happening on this side of it and the things that are being said by some of our kids? Why do my kids love this so much? So there's a fantastic sociologist. Her name is Genevieve Bell. At the Delight Conference 2014, and again, link posted here, there were five basic things that she said about the human condition. And, you know, of course, a lot of people want to take issue with this, but that's not really the point of contention today. The issue is that all of this revolves around we need friends, family, connection, and we want to belong to a community. Well, for many of our kids, this is true as well, that their lives are being defined and being given meaning by the connections that they have online, by the connections that they make and they keep. It's growing to become a definition of part of their identity and who they are. So it's very important that we're having conversations with them about it early on, because they are getting these devices early on. Now, if any of you have not read, we need to go back. If any of you have not read a book called It's Complicated by Dana Boyd, I would highly recommend this, and I do not often recommend that anybody go buy a book. I have my own book that I would be asking you to buy if that was what I did during my presentations. But It's Complicated is a fantastic book. Go get it from the library. Go borrow a copy. But this is a great book about what's happening with kids and how they're developing with these things in mind. Okay? Just a couple of quotes from Dana Boyd, and you can see some of the things that she's talking about in the book and the points that she's making about what's happening with our students now. This is really important. This goes back to, why do you hand an 8-year-old a device that's connected to the world outside if you're not going to talk to them about what happens? They do not have, like somebody mentioned earlier, they don't understand. They might not have the maturity level that goes along with managing this device. Now, the flip side of that is that the world's not going to end because they have these devices. Comic books were supposed to be terrible. Rock and roll music was supposed to be terrible. Teaching the alphabet and writing to people was supposed to be terrible. Everybody's got an opinion about that, but at the end of the conversation, are we teaching them to use the tool correctly or not? And that's what it boils down to. And who's teaching them? I'm going to jump past the rest of the stuff for Boyd for the sake of time. So it's really important that we communicate with students how the rest of the world is using that online information to make determinations about them and their futures.
Somebody I've known for almost a decade now. Well, historically, it's been verbal, where you trusted the person you were talking to, and then we had things like patents and ability, but anyone saw a knight's tale knows that those could be forged. And, you know, so we had official papers, which enabled trust on a local scale, but modern identity has really been around photo ID, where you had passports and driver's license and student cards that enabled trust on a global scale, so that I could prove that I was Canadian, that I live here, and that I went to UBC, and that I'm over 21. And, you know, so identity is what I say about me, what others say about me. Of course, what others say is more trusted. So, you know, identity is really reputation. You know,
that's the key. That's the key right there. Identity is reputation. And the identities that our kids establish online for themselves by their behavior online is going to determine how people look at them as they go forward in the world. And so, who's looking? You know, when we talk about who's looking at what they do, well, the NSA is definitely looking. We found that out through all kinds of news media. But employers are looking as well. Employers are looking at people's behavior online when they determine whether or not you're a good fit for their company. And you might have a stellar resume, but Facebook can shut that down for you pretty quick. This is happening to people, okay? This is really happening to people. So while I think it's very funny as far as the cartoon goes, it's really happening to real people. We're going to talk about a couple examples of that. There is a, by the way, there's a great set of acronyms that have been released that parents really should know, and I would encourage anybody to share it with their parents if they get a hold of the presentation and the link. So, real-world examples of effects. Now, for the sake of time, again, I won't go into too many of these, but, and I hate to have a favorite. I really hate to have a favorite, but this is my favorite of all time. Twitter gets you fired in 20 characters or less. Okay, so this person gets a job offer from Cisco and says, Cisco just offered me a job. Now I have to weigh the utility of a fatty paycheck against the daily commute to San Jose and hating the work. And Tim Lamod, who is a channel partner for Cisco, says, who's the hiring manager? I'm sure they would love to know that you will hate the work. We here at Cisco are versed in the web. By the way, yes, this did happen, okay? This person lost his job before he got to Cisco. So, to recap, $100,000 plus job and blew the offer before he walked in the door because he had to let his fingers do the talking. Now, this is the one that came up before regarding Amy Dunbar. How many years, just in the chat box real quick, how many years does it take to get through medical school? And when you say four, you are talking about after the bachelor's degree and some other stuff, right? Okay, it takes a long time. 8 to 10, so we're agreed that it's about 8 to 10 years of your life, okay? All right, 8 to 10 years of your life. And Amy Dunbar had this to say regarding her patient. So I have a patient who's chosen to either no-show or be late, sometimes hours, for all of her prenatal visits, ultrasounds, and NSTs. She's now 3 hours late for her induction. May I show up late to her delivery? Amy did not mention her name. Amy did not give anything else, okay? She gave some other information that could potentially be, you know, be confidential in nature and could lead somebody to know who it was. But Amy is no longer practicing because Amy felt the need to get on social media and drop this out. Okay? Because this is how people feel. And it doesn't matter how amazing a doctor she is, that one person says, if you're the hospital administrator, this girl is gone. So, again, you know, how do we communicate to our kids that, by the way, you can really screw things up for yourself by doing these things and by running your mouth online? What is a EULA? Does anybody in our audience know what a EULA is? You can either just say no or type out what it is. Okay, but all of you have agreed to these. In fact, you agreed to one when you downloaded the GoToMeeting. Yeah, and user license agreement. And basically, what it says is that we have the right to use certain forms of communication that you will use during this transmission or whatever it is you use to create statistics, to make determinations about future use of our application, to do all kinds of things. And very few people know what they're agreeing to at any given time. One of my apps asked for access to my camera, and it's a financial app. So I asked them what their rationale was for having access to the camera, and they said, oh, well, it's so that you can upload your profile picture. I'm not buying it, and so I'm not giving them permission to access my camera. You should know what you're agreeing to, because kids need to know what they're agreeing to, and that's a conversation we need to have with them. We are all part of big data, folks. What we are doing this second is part of big data, okay? Actively engaging at all online makes us part of big data. That's not a bad thing, but we need to know how that's being used, because companies use all of that information to say, hey, we've got X number of users that are using GoToMeeting today, and so we're going to fund them, or we're going to invest in them, or there's a lot of decisions that are made using big data. So aside from people doing damage to themselves, there's also the possibility that kids can have issues because other people deal with them online and start to talk them into things. Now, I'm going to tell you two quick stories. I've had two students, one male and one female. Both of them were high school students at the time. Both of them were talked into waiting until their parents left, packing a bag, and meeting somebody, getting into a car. One of them wound up in South Carolina. Luckily, her father found her, was able to track her information. The other one was found in Florida because he called his mom. Luckily, both of my students did not have absolutely horrendous things happen to them, but they were taken from their homes, and it all began with online conversation. If we spin back to last month, and I don't know if this is something that's available to you or not through Gwen, but I did a webinar last month on identity development of teens. And one of the reasons that teens look at this is they want to belong somewhere, but if you've worked with teenagers for any length of time, you know that the majority of them, even though they're in groups of 2,500 in some schools, feel completely isolated at times. Even though they've got all these people that they hang out with, each one of them at some level feels isolated. And so Gwen has just told me she'll make that webinar recording available to the participants. Excellent. But that deals with a lot of the why. That deals with a lot of the reason that they are particularly using social media to get there. And part of it is access. Part of it is the fact that I can find a group that's like me, that has my similar interests and the things that I like online, and they might be across the country, but I can communicate with them. That's different than it was 20 years ago, where in order to have that level of communication, I would have to write to somebody or call them on the phone. And by the way, that phone call was going to cost me like $80 for a half an hour or something crazy like that. But now, it's easy and inexpensive communication. And so there are those issues out there. And they have to be addressed and they have to be dealt with. And, you know, there are parents who are unaware that there's potential for this. Great site, by the way, in case you are not already aware of it, called NetSmarts. And NetSmarts has a lot of information for you to share with parents and other educators about what happens with students' information and how quickly you can find out about somebody. So we've got about, I think we've got 9 minutes, and Gwen, correct me if I'm wrong, well, it looks like 10:53, so we need to wrap this up by 11, right? Okay, so I'm going to spin through this. There are effects on college. Colleges in 2013 reported that they were using social media to check in on kids. There are college applications that are being denied because of social media. All right? 29% of admissions officers surveyed have used Google. 31, Facebook. 30, found something online that negatively impacted a student's admissions chances. 1 out of 3 of our kids are being affected negatively by social media as far as their college applications. Career. This guy posted his paycheck on Instagram. See ya. Colleges have made it a point now to help students scrub their online footprints. That must say something about what they're doing while they're running around in college or stuff that they've created prior that makes that a priority for them to get a job. What are employers looking for? There are some employers that are looking exclusively on social media now, and they're ignoring a resume, particularly marketing and advertising, because those are primary sources for social media as primary resources for advertising and marketing now. When is your opinion not okay? Well, there are some instances where maybe you're a teacher, maybe you're a cop, maybe you're looking at something else where they don't want you to just throw out there every private detail about your life. And some people are being released from their jobs as a result. When a church choir has to start singing on Sunday about keeping your business off Facebook, I think we can tell how prevalent it's become. So we're going to scroll through real quick. We want to talk about what students can do very briefly. Okay? And by the way, these are two examples of me, information from 1996 and 1989 that's on the web. What should we help them do? Brand themselves. We need to teach them how to brand themselves. We need to tell them that they need to develop their web presence, that they should start blogging, they should start posting about things that they like, about positive efforts, about stuff that they do that is contributing to their community and their society. They should take efforts to make sure that the web presence that they create that's positive is what they want people to see first, okay? Appropriate and are positive. Have them, help them think forward about what they want people to see and the image that they want people to know about them going forward so that they can then put that information out there and start to really make an impact on what they're looking at. By the way, this should not be a surprise, but it's true. Best behavior gains group connections. If you behave well in your social networks, you will get the most connections. Anybody who's done anything relative to industry knows that connections are how you get jobs. There are ways to purify your online reputation if you've already blown it. But listen to the experts. Your reputation is the currency that matters. Control what is always available to everyone. There are sites out there that tell you this is an appropriate way to use LinkedIn and things on personal branding. And these are this is really good information to share with your kids as well as ways to damage that. We should be teaching kids character education about their online behavior early on. Because behavior is behavior, period. Have the conversation, rinse, lather, repeat, unless you're me, because I don't have any hair. Teach your kids to be discerning about people and information online. You know, people have the ability to self-publish these days. They put photos of themselves online. Now, selfies are not a disorder. People have been doing them forever. However, there are certain selfies that they might want to be real careful of. Social media is not your friend. It's a business. And you are the product. We need to teach kids personal responsibility because technology is only a tool. I can use this to tear a wall down. I can use this to build a wall. It's up to me. And it's what I learn. It's what somebody teaches me. There's a lot of good stuff that's happening out there, and you can look at these when you get the PowerPoint. And plus, you know, there's some awesome stuff that happens out there. So, if you'd like to join the conversation about how technology is changing what we do and who we are as a society, here's my contact information. Gwen, I hope and I haven't gone too far over time. And if anybody wants to contact me and ask questions or follow up, feel free. Thank you for coming today. And I hope you all have a great rest of your week.
This is Gwen again. I would just like to say a big thank you to Eric for sharing just such a wealth of knowledge, information, sort of a historical perspective, but also a very contemporary, modern perspective on all that's available to our students. I certainly have quite a few notes here. I've just now sent out Eric's email address as well as my email address. I will send out a follow-up email to all of the participants today so that you'll have access to these recordings. And then please do email Eric, as I will be doing, to ask for this PowerPoint so that we can link out to some of the fantastic resources that he sent. I also want to check the question board just to see if there is any question for Eric before I let him go. I do see from Sophia, she says, thank you, this was great. Kirsty, another participant, says thank you. So does Michelle. She also says thank you. So thank you all as participants. Is there any question, a burning question, that you'd like to pose to Eric before we end today's session? And if so, please feel free to put that in the questions box as well. Eric, I would love to know the name of your book, if you don't mind sharing it.
My book is it's actually for new school counselors, anybody who's new to a position or maybe a brand new counselor. It is the Mechanics of School Counseling Workbook. If you looked on my LinkedIn profile, you'll see it there. And that's available through NCYI, the National Center for Youth Issues.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, I don't see any questions that have come in. Again, thank you to everyone. Thank you again, Eric, and we will be in touch. I hope everyone has a great rest of your day.
You too. Take care, everybody.